sure our microphones are on. And so we have a 2016 special election, and that is coming up March 1st. And the ballots have been mailed out, so technically when you get your ballot, you can receive your ballot, you can vote, and then you can mail it back. You can also bring it to City Hall, to the City Clerk's office. So technically voting is starting as of now. The ballots have been mailed out. And the election takes place on March 1st. So you can always bring it to City Hall, and you can also mail back your ballot. Anyway, tonight we have the two City Council candidates here for the debate. And we have Stacey Armato, and we have Trent Larson. And they've agreed that Trent is going to go first on his opening statement. So we'll have opening statements, we'll get into questions. And about 30, 40 minutes into the debate, there will be audience questions. So if you think of a question, definitely want to come up, and we'll answer pretty much everybody's question when they come up for audience questions. Okay, the first, the opening statement will go first to Trent. And then when we do closing statements, Stacey will be doing the closing statements first. But obviously, after each question, it's going to rotate back and forth. So Trent, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself, and you have 3 minutes for your opening statement.
Thank you very much. And thank you very much for coming tonight. I really appreciate all of you in the audience. And I'm so looking forward to this debate tonight so that we can talk about the future of Hermosa Beach. And I want you to know that one of the things that people want to know is, well, why is Trent running, and is he qualified to run, and what would he offer to the city of Hermosa Beach? And just so everybody knows, I moved to Hermosa Beach in 2003 and raised a family. My daughter is now touring Redondo Beach High School tonight to see if she's going to go there or MiraCosta. And I have worked for the same company for 27 years. I am in sales, and I call on the Los Angeles marketplace, and I call on very large corporate customers. And I've been successful with Office Depot. So I've had a lot of training in that regard. One of the things you should know about Trent is that I'm a very straightforward person. I talk clearly and to the point, and I don't really hide my agenda. So that when you're talking to me or you hear me up on the dais, you'll know where I'm coming from. And I really don't like to ask questions that aren't tough questions. For example, we all might remember Sam Donaldson, the famous ABC reporter. I kind of like to model myself after him, where he really asked tough questions and was trying to get to the point. And one of the things that I've done throughout, you know, I ran in November and was unsuccessful. But what I've tried to do is to let people know where I stand on the issues. And so I've been writing in the paper every week, and I've been taking position statements, and I've been explaining myself in 250 words or less where I stand on some important issues. And for example, last week I wrote about our carbon neutrality goals and how I support a lot of what we do, but I don't support us purchasing carbon offset credits, and I talked about why. I also talked about some of the hot topics in Hermosa, for example, short-term rentals, and how I would not vote to overturn that, and how I do think we need to update our parking standards because I think it's anti-business and anti-growth. I also talked a lot about an article I called Freshwater Politics, which is about the desalinization plant that they want to put in El Segundo, and how I think that's good for our community. And I know these are difficult issues. These are things that people disagree on and have honest disagreements. But I want you to know that you will know where it is I'm coming from and how I got there. This week in the paper, I'm talking about political diversity and how, for example, here on the dais, I think it would be beneficial to have different points of view. And I think that's why one of the main reasons why people might vote for me.
You can summarize that.
Okay. So having said all of that, thank you so much for being here. And I look forward to the rest of the evening.
Great. Thanks, Trent. Stacey?
Thanks, Al. Thank you, everyone, for being here and for having me. As the mother of three children, an attorney, and the wife to a local small business owner, I've been active in this community for a bunch of years, and since the day we moved here, actually. I care deeply about our community, and I have a strong desire to serve its residents. While serving as the chairperson of Stop Hermosa Beach Oil and as a member of the Community Dialogue Financial Committee, Measure H Steering Committee, and our Chief's Police Advisory Board, I realized that I shared our community's desire to build a strong and resilient financial foundation for a clean, green, and safe Hermosa Beach. Decisions on the important issues facing us, like shaping the new general plan, downtown revitalization, hotels and other development proposals, and the implementation of Hermosa's overwhelming rejection of oil drilling in Hermosa Beach, will establish our city's direction for the next 30 years. These are important times. The challenges we face must be approached with honesty, transparency, creativity, cooperation, and certainly a full measure of community input. As a member of your city council, I will strive to build consensus, work respectfully with residents and businesses alike to move our city forward in a manner we can all be proud of. Thank you.
Thanks, Stacey. Okay, we will go to the first debate questions, and the candidates have received all these debate questions in advance and background material that goes with it. So the first debate question had to do with a city council special meeting, which happened on January 9th, and it was kind of an all-encompassing issue paper study session. So they basically had 12 major issues having to do with the city, sewer financing, just all kinds of major issues. And basically, these things are ongoing goals that are to be completed, and also goals that are kind of getting started out. And pretty much, as a city council member, they'll be making decisions on these goals if and when if they're elected. And so I'll go to the first question dealing with those the issue papers, which they had at that special meeting. Debate question one. From the Hermosa Beach City Council special meeting issue paper study session on January 9th, there were 12 issue papers about major issues and projects that were identified in 2015 and will carry over into 2016. Give us your list of the high priority issues from the 12 major issues and projects that absolutely must go forward in 2016, and that'll be for Trent.
Okay, thank you, Alan. I'd like to start with the number one being our economic development plan, and that would include some of the major projects that we've been talking about, including Skechers, including the Strand and Pier Hotel, and including the H2O. I think our economic development is critical to remaking and revitalizing Hermosa Beach. The number two item coming off the heels of that would be to implement our downtown core revitalization strategy. And that's all of the things that we want to make the downtown family-friendly, more diverse, have more of a daytime feel, and get more people on foot traffic downtown and have more activity downtown. Number three, I would say that it is our city facility strategic plan. The city facilities in Hermosa Beach need to be rebuilt. I don't think there's any question about that. Our city is in between two very wealthy cities and right in front of another one, Torrance, NPV. All the cities around us have beautiful facilities for their city facilities, and we pay enough in taxes and have enough revenue in this town to rebuild our city. We just need to be smart about how we do it, and I believe that the city should be rebuilt. After that, I believe the street and the sewers are critical, because paved roads and new sidewalks and the sewers working properly is blocking and tackling essential business of the city. From there, I would say our long-term financial plan, the draft plan, and things kind of get lost in the shuffle after that, but they're all important. But really, I would focus first and foremost on the economic development, and that would be the hotel, Skechers, and the H2 project, because I think that jumpstarts and kickstarts everything else that we need to do, and we can pivot off of that growth.
Thanks, Trent. Stacey?
Let me start by saying I think all the issues presented are important. I think we all need to step back, though, and see big picture. Do we ever really think about where we want to be as a city? And that's really, really important. That being said, I think that Plan Hermosa should be our utmost top priority. We have one chance to get that right, and it's going to be something that guides our community for many, many years to come. That would go hand in hand with our long-term financial plan. In Plan Hermosa, we should address carbon neutrality, the improvements for downtown, PCH Aviation, and the overall look we want at the entry points of our community. Another priority that's already underway, which I'm very happy about, are the infrastructure improvements. And finally, we should formally implement the decision-making tool into many of our processes across our departments and our committees as soon as possible. This important guideline was created by many of us that worked very long and hard to get it just right as a basis for making decisions in our town.
Thanks, Stacey. Okay, debate question two, and basically it's the exact same topic of the 12 issue papers, what the candidates are going to be, I'll read the question. Give us your list of the low priority issues from the 12 major issues and projects that can be delayed to 2017 or later. Why should these projects be delayed, reduced, or canceled? Trent?
Okay. Well, none of these topics can be absolutely delayed or canceled, I don't believe. They're all on the list for very important reasons. So, having said that, when I answer this question, I want you to know that I'm not advocating that we delay or cancel any of these. But some of them kind of take care of themselves and are very simple, should be simple fixes. Communications out of the city shouldn't be complicated to the residents. It shouldn't be. With all the media we have now and all the ways that we can get communication out, it should be simple. The PCH Aviation project is going to take some time because it's just now getting going, so it's going to be naturally pushed down on its own. The fire services delivery, we already have a fire department. They're taking care of things. We need to look at that, but again, that's kind of one of those issues that we need to debate and talk through, and that's going to take some more time. After that, the employee compensation is moving through. That has a large to do with the city manager, and the council's going to have to vote on it, but the real guts to that is handled by Tom, and the city council just needs to give them direction. In terms of the carbon neutrality plan, I think that's kind of medium level. We can do a lot of things like add in the EV charging stations. We could redo the city fleet and have CNG-powered vehicles. We can talk about solar panels on some of our existing facilities, but we have to be careful when we're putting those in, because if we're going to rip down the building, then what's the payback? And maybe we can get it back in 3 years. Yeah, we can do that. I think we're doing a good job with our policing. I think they're the biggest budget in the city. But we live in a safe community, we're doing a good job, so I don't need to think that needs to be really, jumped on. But again, all of these are important, but where I think the council should focus is the things that are going to help jumpstart the economic engine of this town, and also make sure that the residents are being taken care of with just basic things like the streets repaving.
Thanks, Trent. Stacey?
There are a lot of issues that I personally believe should not have been enumerated, mostly because they should be expected of our staff to accomplish in normal day-to-day operations, like employee compensation, policy and contracts that should constantly be evaluated, fire services, and community policing, crime, and downtown enforcement. Those should always be things that we're focusing on in our community. Other items seemed a little mundane. I wouldn't enumerate them as actual priorities per se, but I would resolve them quickly in city council meetings as recommended by staff. And those items include our communications, protocol for meeting minutes, and finally, the use of city property for city classes and gatherings.
Thanks, Stacey. Okay, we will go on to debate question three. Basically, it deals with a different document. And that document is the background for this question is it's an implementation of the downtown core revitalization strategy. So the next three questions will be related to that. And that's been something that's been going on for the downtown and our plan and how to revitalize that area down there. And one of the things in the downtown core revitalization strategy is to identifying of the parking problems, and the first debate question has to do with one of those solutions to parking problems, and that is to build a multi-level parking structure somewhere in Hermosa Beach, and I'll list them really quickly. One of them is Lot A, parking Lot A, that is directly to the south of Pier Plaza. There's a big lot that holds about 100 cars on a surface lot, and one thing you could do is build a multi-level parking garage there. You'd have more parking in the downtown. The next multi-level parking lot possibility is the Civic Center. So this structure here, they're possibly thinking of rebuilding the police and fire department, having a new city hall, and then underneath you could have a parking garage right here at this building located right here. That would give you an additional parking for the downtown, even though we're not in the downtown. The third option for a multi-level parking structure would be at the community center, which is directly to the east of us. It's on the corner of PCH and Pier Avenue. And in the areas where the tennis courts are and skateboard park, you could build a multi-level parking garage there, and that would provide parking, and the thought is that people would walk down Pier Avenue to the downtown and then use that structure. So anyway, that has been talked about a good bit of time, and so within this downtown implementation strategy. Here is debate question 3. What is your opinion regarding the financing and construction of one or more large multi-level parking structures in order to serve visitor car parking in, for the Hermosa Beach downtown area? How would the city finance the construction of a multi-million dollar parking garage? Trent?
Okay. All right, okay. I'm not exactly sure if we should build a big parking garage in Hermosa Beach, another one, but if we did, I would recommend right now that we build it here on the city site and have it underground. Because if you, downtown, we don't need another big cement monolith. That property, if it was going to be rebuilt, could be something much more useful, much more where the public could go, and where we could raise tax revenue from selling things, you know, restaurants and things like that. And also, I don't believe the city should run the parking garage like we do now down there, because I think it should be managed by a private company, and I don't think we should finance it on our own either. We should have a public-private partnership if we're going to build the city when we redo the city hall. I believe the parking in general, you know, needs, the whole parking requirement issue needs to be looked at in a big way, because I think we're hampering our businesses downtown with the parking requirements that we are putting on them. But for example, if we were to build one up here, people could walk to downtown very easy. If we put one up at the community center, they're going to have to walk across the busy intersection and make that busy intersection even more busy than it already is. And people are skateboarding through there and all kinds of things right now, and you're going to have more accidents and more problems. So here makes more sense to me, where we're at here at City Hall. And I think downtown, since it's so close to the beach, and we have so much to offer down there, that we don't need to put a great big concrete box right downtown.
Thanks, Trent. Stacey?
Thank you. I also do not support building more parking structures downtown. That real estate is far too valuable. We have a parking structure downtown. We need to preserve views where we can, and building a new parking structure would not serve that purpose. I support building a subterranean parking at the community center. It would support the needs of our theater, of our community center, the library, city hall, farmers market, upper pier, and encourage walking throughout our community. I would want to explore similar financing like we used for our current parking structure. In that situation, the county put up the money for the structure, and we are paying them back over time with revenue sharing on a parking revenue. Finally, when determining the size of the actual parking structure, subterranean or not, we should remember that the number of people using Uber and Lyft are increasing, and that's only going to get more and more so over the years to come. There's no need to overbuild when these services are becoming increasingly popular and practical.
Thanks, Stacey. Okay, debate question 4. The background on this is also dealing with this downtown core revitalization and parking, and one of the things that they're planning, or the thoughts are, is to provide incentives to redevelop buildings in the downtown. And these would be privately owned commercial buildings that are difficult to build or rebuild right now, because if they were to knock it down, they would have to provide parking, and that is sometimes difficult. And one of the ways to get around that would be to reduce the parking requirements, and then the owner could build a, you know, multi-level within the building height and everything, and so take down a building there, so, and redevelop, it's called. So, the background is, real quickly, there are many existing single-story commercial buildings that were built in the 1910s, 1920s, into the 1950s in the Hermosa Beach downtown area. Some people believe that these 60 to 100-year-old single-story commercial buildings provide a unique character and scale to the Hermosa Beach downtown. The downtown core revitalization is proposing numerous incentives and provision to minimize the impact in parking, which will allow the redevelopment of these buildings. Debate question four, do you support the granting of any new parking incentives, zoning modifications, or new land rights to promote the demolition and redevelopment of 60 to 100-year-old buildings in the downtown area? How many of these older single-story buildings in the downtown should be knocked down and replaced with modern multi-story commercial buildings? Trent?
Okay, well, it's sort of a loaded question, but I'm going to answer it this way, that we need to address the parking requirements for our businesses downtown because it's choking them off, and it's not letting them rebuild or remake themselves or retool. And, you know, the idea that if we relax the parking structures that all of a sudden every building is going to go up and it's going to be a 30-foot tall building is just not reality, because it takes an entrepreneur, it takes a vision, it takes a plan, it takes an investment banker to fund them, and then they have to build, and they want to make it something that the people are going to come to and be happy with. So the idea that we're just going to rip down all these buildings because somebody doesn't have the same parking requirements as we have right now, I just think is not true. I just don't think it works like that. Now, our downtown, definitely compared to, say, downtown Manhattan Beach, is not as new and not as fresh, and it doesn't attract the same amount of visitors. And I think if you're a restaurateur or a business owner downtown, you would want the parking requirements loosened so that there can be more commerce and more activity. But I don't think that just because you did that, that you would have just a wholesale uprooting of our older buildings and destroy the character of downtown Hermosa Beach. Besides, things change over time. Nothing stays the same. When Hermosa Beach was built, it was different. Anytime you put up a building, it's different. So you can't keep things the same. Nothing stays the same forever. And I think people would want to build within the character of Hermosa Beach because you're investing your hard-earned money as an entrepreneur in that building, and you want people to come to it.
Thanks, Brent. Stacey?
Thank you. The answer to the question is no, I would not support that. This is something, however, that should be addressed in Plan Hermosa. Something to consider are the in-lieu fees that are currently paid. I think that those should go towards promoting alternate forms of transportation. We could put that towards a more walkable, safe downtown. And finally, it's a good opportunity to explore incentives for property owners to preserve their 60 to 100-year-old buildings.
Okay, thanks, Stacey. Okay, debate question five, the background edit, is also on the downtown core revitalization. The downtown core revitalization proposes new outdoor dining and seating on public sidewalks, which would allow for reduced parking requirements to be granted in order to convert existing non-resident, non-restaurant uses and convert them to restaurant uses. Part of this is, the thought is to add outdoor dining to the establishments on Upper Pier Avenue and, of course, open new establishments on Upper Pier. Debate question five. The proposed downtown core revitalization strategy allows for outdoor dining and seating and would allow for reduced parking requirements for converting existing restaurants and non-restaurant uses to restaurants. Any new existing restaurant in Hermosa Beach that does not have alcohol service can get an alcohol service if they, and that can be done by right. So if they open up a new restaurant and decide to close by 10 p.m., the alcohol license would not go through the CUP process. It could just be granted by right. So basically, let's see what we got here. Oh yeah, here is the question. Do you support the adding of private business encroachments to Upper Pier Avenue? So this could include on the sidewalks, A-frames, retail product signs, and seating for snack shops. Do you support permanently fenced outdoor dining areas on Upper Pier Avenue, public sidewalks for existing new for new or existing alcohol-serving restaurants. And the note on that is, if you're an alcohol-serving restaurant and you want to serve alcohol on your outdoor dining area, it must be a permanently fenced area similar to Pier Plaza. So you can't just set seats out and chairs. And that would be for Trent.
Could you repeat the question?
Yeah. That's the problem.
You know, I want the sidewalks clear, okay? So if you can't walk up and down the sidewalk and somebody wants to put a table and chairs there, then no, I don't want restaurants to be able to clog up the sidewalk because I don't want people walking in the street. Now, if a restaurant has an area that is technically outside but not clogging up the sidewalk, then yes, I'd say, okay, you can have seating out there. It's a free country. You own the property. You can have people sit out there. Nobody wants to sit out, you know. I'm okay with that. I mean, we have some restaurants like that right now. Now, little A-frame signs outside the business, I'm probably okay with, because you can move an A-frame back and it can take up this much room. And if people want to advertise their sandwich shop or their sale of the day, I don't think that's a problem. But in general, you know, this would be the rule of common sense on this one. If you can't walk down the sidewalk, then no, they can't have a table there. But if there's room for it, like Lori Ford's place, Gumtree, outside where she has tables and chairs, then yes, for certainly we would have that. And on the pier, I think there's room for some outside eating like there already is.
Thanks, Trent. Stacey?
Thank you. I would support A-frame signs, but I would have to have some clear guidelines that go with that the businesses follow strictly. If there was enough room on a sidewalk to allow for proper access, kind of in line with what Trent was saying, I would support limited outdoor seating for snack shops. I'm less inclined to support permanently fenced areas on the sidewalk for restaurants to serve alcohol because I'm not convinced there's proper space, and we need to be careful about expanding the footprint for restaurants that serve alcohol. We should also note that a few places have done a really good job within their own existing footprint to allow for outdoor seating. That's The Source, Gumtree, Crema de la Crepe, Hook and Plow, and Rockefeller. And finally, we need to remember that we can provide an environment where businesses can thrive, and we need to also keep in mind the community that we all want to live in.
Thanks, Stacey. Okay, that's the end of the downtown core questions. We have audience questions now. So at every one of these debates, we want the audience to come up and ask questions, and basically would ask that when you ask an audience question, it is posed to both candidates. So we would prefer that you don't ask an attack question, but whatever question you'll be asking, both candidates will be answering the same question. So anybody in the audience interested?
You got one?
This is, yeah, come on up.
Thank you very much for putting this on. Good to see you. Hi, nice. Thank you for both coming and sharing your opinions and thoughts tonight. My question has to do about the city's general plan that we're in the process of creating. And it's my understanding that a general plan is supposed to preserve the distinct character of a town and prevent infrastructure overload. Fairly basic, fairly simple. But it seems to me that this draft is general plan is way too specific, and so it's not really a general plan but more of a specific plan, especially compared to the quote old general plan, and so as often referred to by the consultant. One of the things that was brought up specifically in the general plan was, and I'd like to know, you may not be following this closely, and if not, that's okay, just kind of a thought question. If you are able to answer, great. Residents were heard loud and clear, don't touch density. But then the qualifier was said, except in a few specific situations. I was never given a clear understanding of what that was, except in a few specific situations that they were suggesting that they were not going to touch density and referring to the housing element. So basically, if you don't know what that means now, would you try to get clarity on what that means for us? So if you do know what that means, the few specific situations. I would like to hear your feedback on that.
Great. Thanks, Tracy.
Thanks.
That'd be for Trent.
Okay, so I'll address density as I know it in the city of Hermosa Beach. I am not in favor of converting like R1 residential lots to R2 lots. I am not in favor of high density housing like apartment buildings if in fact it's not zoned that way already. So I don't want to increase the density in the residential community of Hermosa Beach. Where I do think we have some room, and some could argue this is density, is that I do think the Skechers business project, the buildings, the office buildings, should be built. And I believe that that will help Hermosa Beach. It's 500 full-time jobs. Now that brings people into Hermosa, but these are people who work professionally. Now also the Strand and Pier project. Okay, right now you're going to be replacing the Mermaid and the Poop Deck, you know, with a brand new hotel, and some might say, well, that's increasing density, but we're going to have tourists coming to town and staycations from around the area, like you do up in Palos Verdes now, and I think, you know, one could argue that, but I would be in favor of that. So there are pockets where I think the density could go up, but certainly not in the residential communities of Hermosa Beach.
Thanks, Brent. Stacey?
Thank you. Thanks for your question, Tracy. I happened to ask the consultant at a sit-down with her recently that exact question. The answer I received was it was going to be mixed use in particular parts of town. It would be retail on the bottom and residential on top. It sounds like a decent concept, but until we see it in the plan, I really don't know how to interpret that, okay? So she didn't really feel like it would seriously impact density, but clearly it would impact it to some degree. You brought up preserve our distinct character. We need to keep that in mind when we look at this plan. That's why I'm happy the city is opening up many opportunities for the residents to speak about Plan Hermosa. I've seen a lot of you at those meetings making comments, and I can tell you that your council is paying attention, and it's going to need to reflect the vision of the community as a whole. So, thank you.
Thanks, Stacey. Any other questions? Come on up. Hi, Matt.
Good evening, Al. Good evening, Stacey, Trent. My question is regarding carbon neutrality. I heard both of you speak and answer a question earlier. I seen you had different opinions on it. So my question is this. Trent, you said you oppose our city purchasing carbon credits.
Carbon offsets.
And my question for you, Stacey, is I guess you're supporting us buying carbon credits?
This would be for both candidates. Okay, if you can pose the question, they're okay. Going to answer the same question.
Thank you, Al. I'll rephrase the question. The question is, if you could define what you think carbon credits are and how you think it will benefit the city of Hermosa.
Thanks, Matt. Be for Trent.
Okay, so investing in Hermosa Beach is what responsible government does, okay? I wrote an article about carbon neutrality just last week. I believe in almost all of our carbon neutrality goals are good for Hermosa Beach, and I'm not saying carbon offset credits are bad. I have customers who buy carbon offset credits. But I think our money for the city of Hermosa Beach is better spent on infrastructure. So instead of buying carbon offset credits with our money, the city's money, public money, that we spend that money on other things that get us closer to a carbon neutrality goal. And that would be all the things like EV charging stations. That would be solar panel installations. That would be CNG vehicles, street light, traffic signals. Perhaps we could bank some of that money to make our new buildings LED certified or LEED certified. We could help maybe businesses offer some incentives for LED lighting so that maybe they could replace some of their lighting with new lighting. That's a good thing. Also, community choice aggregation, which is a big word for buying green power. I think that's a laudable concept and that we should allow and that we should explore that. But I do think the residents should have the choice to opt in. Right now, that is an opt-out choice, and I think it's better to opt in on that because it protects people. Because it's going to cost more money to buy green power, but I do think it's a laudable effort. The carbon offset credits, they go out and they can be for lots of very worthy projects, and I have customers who buy them, and they buy them to get LEED certified, or they buy them because they're mass marketers, or Target, or Kmart, people like that, and they want the publicity. But for public policy, I think it's better to spend that money on nuts and bolts stuff, that money stays in town and doesn't leave town.
Thanks, Brent. Stacey?
Thank you, and thanks, Matt, for the question. No, if the implication was that I would support then purchasing offset credits, that is not the case. I think that when we look at Plan Hermosa, we need to be mindful about carbon neutrality. And when I said we really need to think about where we want to be as a community, I believe that carbon neutrality can play a strong factor in that and really set us apart from some other communities. Getting there with purchasing carbon offsets, that doesn't get us anywhere. I think that doesn't provide much vision for this town. And I would want us to work into the general plan a strict guideline for achieving carbon neutrality over the course of years that we could realistically live through. purchasing offset credits is not the way I'd envision us getting there. So that answers your question.
Thanks, Stacey. Anybody else? Now's your chance. Hi, Marie.
Hi, Al. Hello, candidates. Marie Rice. We're talking about some really substantive issues tonight, and they're on some very specific topics. And since this is our only opportunity to talk to both of you at the same time, I thought I'd give you the opportunity, both of you, to tell us something about yourselves that we might be surprised to hear.
Thanks, Marie. Trent?
Well, I ran last time, so I talked a lot about my personal life, but you know, I was an athlete in college. I put myself through college playing football. I was a team captain my senior year. I played center. I'm still a weightlifter. I'm really strong. And I feel very healthy. I take very good care of myself. And I feel very fortunate. I have a lovely wife and daughter and a beautiful family and a beautiful home. And I'm very easy to chat up. See me around town. Trent's easy to come and talk to. Don't be afraid of Trent. But if you ever need somebody to protect you, something bad goes down, guess what? Yeah, I get there. So that's me in a nutshell. All
right. Thanks, Trent. That's great. Stacey.
Thanks. That's great, Trent. Thanks for the question, Marie. Something that people would be surprised to hear. Some people know about it, some people don't, but many years ago when my oldest was an infant, I was traveling weekly for work, flying, and in that time I was still breastfeeding and I would pump my milk, and on one occasion I was held by the TSA. They wanted to put my milk through the x-ray. Well, of course I knew the rules, and that wasn't part of the rules. I could have an alternate screening, and they didn't like that. They held me for over an hour to make an example of me, and it was a very upsetting experience. And I came away from that situation thinking, not only was I traveling weekly and flying and having to experience it week after week, and I didn't want to have to go through that week after week, but also thinking about the other moms that maybe would have put their milk through the x-ray and how they would feel, and I wanted to prevent that from happening again. So I challenged the U.S. government, and a lot of people aren't successful doing that. Many aren't, and it took a lot of years, 4 years, and we finally came to an agreement with the TSA that they would restructure their policy, retrain all their employees, and that was an excellent outcome and something that a lot of people don't know about me. So there you go. Surprise.
Yeah. Thanks, Stacey. That's great. Anybody else? Okay. Hi, Sandy.
Sandy Simon. Candidates. We've talked a lot of great questions, Al. And the Hermosa plan and downtown core. My question's a little compound when you look at Plan Hermosa and downtown core. Using the issue papers of last week ago, last Saturday, and then last Tuesday, we saw the community development department basically was told a lot of things in core were not on the top 10 list. There was no $4 million. It wasn't a priority. The parking wasn't going to happen. I think the majority of the council said they wouldn't support that. And when you really looked at it, it was about 90% about favoring restaurants, allegedly restaurants or bars that are, want to be restaurants. And that vote was clearly no, but yet the following week, the same issue came right back up to the planning department and the city council again. So it appears that the direction and the transparency that we residents and being fair to retail businesses just doesn't exist in the management of our city. They basically put up what they want, do what they want, and post what they want, and then come back and try to pick it out of the plan and do it again. The plan, if you look at the pictures and you look at what we have around town, I don't think people dining in a tea party in a picture of a Hermosa plan is reflective of what is Hermosa Beach. So again, I see this transparency problem. When you talk about the incentives of economics in the plan, I mean, Skechers is coming here because it wanted to. The people who bought the property for the hotel came because they wanted to build a hotel here. And I forgot the other hotel, the same thing with Raju. I mean, I don't see the city within the plan really reaching out and doing something that really is proactive.
Can you pose that as a question?
Okay, as far as development is concerned. So I see this whole transparency problem, and I really don't see this. I mean, putting more money when there's aviation and Pacific Coast Highway that hasn't gotten a dime in 50 years is not being proactive. If you were elected, do you believe that some of this really exists? And we're not with a loaded question to get somebody, but look at the real issue of what I've just described. Do you believe there's some things here that could be radically improved so the residents and the other businesses are at least represented in both the Hermosa plan and the economic development of this city? Thank you.
Thanks, Andy. That'd be for Trent.
Okay, so the question really centers around, can we get more retail in the downtown area, is I think what Sandy's trying to say, because he doesn't want, you know, every place to be a bar or a restaurant that morphs into a bar. I am in the retail business, and I have been for 27 years, and I can tell you that retail is very, very tough and changing constantly. And one of the biggest changers of that is Amazon and how that drives sales through distribution and through delivery. And retailers, especially in the downtown core, it's very difficult for them to turn money, especially if they're new, because they're probably leasing out their space and the rent is very high, and they have to get really high margins on products that can be sold, that they can purchase much less and quickly and easily online. So the retailer has to be a specialty retailer or own the property so that he doesn't have a huge overhead. It's very difficult. Restaurants have an easier time making it in our town, and economics are what they are. We don't subsidize the businesses, nor should we. So they have to make it on their own. And how many times have you guys seen small places go into business and then go out of business? Little ice cream shops, little donut shops, little coffee shops, because they don't make enough profit to hold on to their space. And restaurants are the only ones that really do really well in the downtown. And I don't think there's a whole lot that a city council can do that. We can try to help other retailers in there. We could persuade people to try to give people a break, but economics are what they are. And that's gonna rule the roost. So I'm in favor of the hotels like I already talked about. I think restaurants in downtown core are great. You opened a brand new restaurant, the Broughton Brow, right? No? Yeah, trying. And they do, and I eat at them all the time. And I think they're wonderful. And I think that that's what makes it. That's what makes it here. People come to Hermosa for that. That's why they're there.
Thank you. Thanks, Trent. Stacey?
Thank you, and thank you, Sandy. I think what you're really trying to get at were two things that you said. Transparency and improving the representation of the residents. Those are two key points that I, and hopefully in the 18 months that if I'm elected I would be serving, I would want to improve on that. You're sitting close to Council Member Fangary, and he's doing a very good job of doing that in our community with his community first meetings. We need more of that. We need more of listening to our residents, hearing what they have to say, and implementing what they want. That includes our business owners, right? There's a lot of, there's a couple of them in this room right now. We need to listen to them. We need to listen to our other residents. We need to come to a good place. So to be surprised about anything, something coming in front of council and then going back to planning and that surprising you or disappointing you and feeling like maybe there's favorites by staff or something, that shouldn't be happening. And I think with more community input and transparency, we can accomplish that. So that would be one of my priorities.
Thanks, Stacey. Anybody else?
All right. Good evening. And thank you two so much for being here, for running. But more importantly, thank you for your service to the community. It's you two are both very impressive candidates. And we already owe you a debt of thanks for running already. Either one of you, as far as I'm concerned, we do really well. But that leads me to my question. It's why we're even here tonight. We had a very, very qualified candidate who was here, but was not committed to Hermosa. Moved out within months. So here's the thing. I don't want to vote for one of you once. I want to vote for one of you twice. Not in one election, but an election and one election after that. Because it's by gaining that experience and commitment to the city that things really happen. So that's my question for you. Do I have a commitment from either one of you that you'll do more than a half a term, but at least a term and a half? Beyond that, hey, whatever. I'd love to vote for either one of you for president. Matter of fact, the way things are going, love to maybe vote for you for president this year if you are running. But, you know, that's my question overall. Do we have more than just a couple years commitment from you?
Thanks for the question. Trent?
Well, I've lived here since 2003, so I've been here this whole time, and I've worked for the same company for 27 years. So I am kind of a lifer and a long-term person. You know, Sue's saying out in the future, I would say, yes, I'm going to be here. And I get into the office, I know I'm going to love it, and I'm going to want to run again. Okay? So my commitment to you is that I love this community, I love this town, that's why I'm running. I ran because I saw so much divisiveness happen, frankly, over O. And I thought, well, I could be the one. I've always been able to do that, to bring people together. I'm a right-of-center person. I don't think that's shocking anybody. But I am able to be a centrist in the person. I played center in football, and I like bringing people together. And I am able to do that. So my commitment is that I win, I'm in, I'm not running out like Nanette. Let's face it, that's her name. And I promise to be here for you.
Thanks, Trent. Stacey?
Thank you. I totally hear you. If I'm elected and I can serve out, I would serve out this term. If everyone supported me, I would run again, and I would be happy to do that. I think we need to play out how the next 18 months would go. Something really important is the makeup of the council and everyone getting along and getting things done. And if we can provide that to you, I would hope to be supported in another election and continue that commitment. Thank you.
Thanks, Stacey. Anybody else? Hi, Craig.
Good evening. Thank you both for being here and thank you for putting this on. I have a need to set up the question and have a question I'd like to ask you both. Many people in this community are deeply concerned for the health and well-being of not only the residents, but also the environment. And we've seen comments in the papers and both a while ago and recently regarding certain issues that are very important for the entire South Bay area, including the residents of Hermosa Beach. I personally think that city councils should get involved deeply in protecting the health and well-being of their residents. And a good example of that is today the American Lung Association released their State of Tobacco Control report for the United States, and they had a report on California, and they grade each city according to the policies the cities do that help protect the health and well-being of their residents. And our neighbor city here, Manhattan Beach, was rated A, and unfortunately, Hermosa Beach was rated D. And this is all the results of how city council gets involved in things that impact the residents. My question is on important environmental issues, such as our previous oil project issue and the upcoming West Basin desalination plans. What do you feel your level of responsibility is in studying the issue, and how do you educate yourself? Where do you find sources of information for you to come up with your position? And I might add that making statements about certain groups that are not factually correct is not appreciated. And so we want to know where you get your information and what your level of responsibility is for these key environmental issues. Thank you.
Thanks, Craig. That'd be for Trent.
Thank you, Craig. I'll address the question. I think, Craig, what you're talking about is the Surfrider Foundation and the desalinization plant. We can get that up in the air. Okay, so I think it's very important that the city council get involved in environmental issues and that the city council take a stand. And as far as doing research, myself, Trent, does a lot of study at night. I go on the internet, I go to Wikipedia, I go to the public websites, I go to West Basin's website, I go to the LA Times, I read a lot of the articles. I saw where, you know, the Surfrider sued Poseidon 14 times and not without merit, it didn't pass. They got Poseidon up and running anyway, so that's why I made that statement. I saw you talk under the microphone, Craig, about that you guys were against this desalinization plant. On the desalinization plant in particular, I actually think it's gonna be great for the South Bay. Now, we have to do the environmental impact report, which I don't think will show any super negative things. There's been laws passed since Poseidon came online in Carlsbad. It's going to have substrate intakes, or at least protectors there. That's also the brine water going out. It's going to be mixed with outflows and or diffusers. And there's a bunch of things that are going to make this thing a state-of-the-art modern factory that's going to protect the residents. I believe people are part of the environment. I believe you cannot extract people out of the environment. The two go hand in hand. I know a lot of times we talk about the environment, we talk about we really don't include us in that. But with water specifically, there's nothing more important to us than fresh water and fresh and clean air. And then the economic health so that we all can do better in our lives. So water is very important. And I think it will benefit the South Bay. And that the outflows out of Hyperion, you know, a lot of people want to take the recycled water, and it's called toilet to tap. It's what it's called. And they want to pump that back into our supply if we run low. But I think before we do that, before we ever even get close to that, we have a desal plant pumping 60 million gallons of fresh water into our pipes locally.
Thanks, Brent. Stacey?
Thank you. And thanks, Craig, for your question. You asked us what we believe our level of responsibility is and if we would properly educate ourselves. I think that most people know my performance on the oil issue. I was deeply committed to that, and it took a couple years, but we did get our council to finally take a stand on that issue. That was very important to me and to a lot of people. I have a strong commitment to the health and safety of our community and also to our environment, and I think that reflects what the majority of our community also feels. As far as desal goes, there's a couple concerns that I have. The cost, the negative effect on the environment, and the energy consumption. So those three factors are of great concern to me, and I think that to be a responsible council, we would need to study this issue and be presented all alternatives to desal and take a position on it. It is in a neighboring community that would affect the ocean that we all enjoy. So I think that it would be our responsibility to say something on that particular issue.
Thanks, Stacey. Anybody else? Okay.
How's it going? Just for the record, it's Binder. For the record, can you just tell us what your stand on oil was, both of you? Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Binder. Trent?
Yes. Well, I did not campaign for it. I stayed quiet the whole time, but I thought we could do it, and I thought we could do it responsibly. I knew it wasn't going to pass. All right? Now, you know, this country lives off fossil fuels. Everything we have in this country, everything. You can't name one thing, and I dare you. I may be the blade of grass flowing through the wind that lands in your yard and grows, but everything we have in this country was made by fossil fuels. Everything. There's not one thing. Anything you do, the restaurant you go to, you go home at night, the bed, the house you built, the saws that cut the wood, that transported the materials, that brought the groceries to the store, that brings the water to your house is pumped. Everything, the electricity that we all make is run by fossil fuels. Everything in this country is run by fossil fuels. Now, having said that, I knew it was going to pass, but I thought we could do it. So I thought we could do it. It didn't pass. I'm over it. We get it someplace else. We have to move on. We have to find other sources of revenue. I'm not upset about it. I know some people are at me, but that was my stance, and so be it. Okay.
Thanks, Trent. Stacey? Yeah.
Thank you. Finder, I was against oil drilling, and I... Yeah. Thanks.
Thanks, Stacey. Anybody else? Okay, yeah, come on up. Hi, George.
Hi, Al. Thank you for putting this forum on, this debate, and I want to thank the candidates for addressing the issues. I'm George Barks. I'm a former councilman and mayor in the city of Hermosa Beach. And as everybody knows, we have $100 million+ of infrastructure needs in the city. And it's not easy to balance the budget. There are a lot of needs, and I disagree with my good friend thinks that PCH Aviation is a project. God, I already forgot his name. I'm getting too old. Sandy Seaman, that thinks that the PCH Aviation project, we shouldn't be spending any money. Now, PCH Aviation is dear to me. I grew up in that area. I own property, commercial property, and own businesses. Okay. So, and I'll address that at a later time. But we need to cut expenses. And what I always advocated when I was on the city council, that we should do more sharing of services with our neighboring cities. Specifically, police and fire. I personally believe we can save a lot of money and our neighboring cities, that we need a South Bay Fire Department, a South Bay Police Department. Services will increase. The cost will come down because at the administrative level. So my question is, are you two at least open to studying and looking at this possibility? That's my question.
Thanks, George. Trent?
So I'm certainly open to looking at, especially the fire department, a South Bay shared services for fire. I think that that is definitely doable before we do that with the police department. But fire department certainly. And George talked about $100 million in infrastructure needs. And how are we going to get that? Well, we're going to have to grow our revenue. I think cutting costs elsewhere in the city government is going to be very difficult. No one wants to cut costs when you're talking about government services. No one. So growing the revenue, I think, is a lot easier. And how do we do that? Well, we've already talked about the hotels. We've talked about Skechers. Property tax goes up every year. So right there, you're going to get an increase in property tax income to the city. You have other things that can come online. An aviation project can bring more revenue to the city, especially if we get businesses going there. And we can forecast our revenue from the property taxes, and we can borrow and build against that for the infrastructure needs. We're certainly not going to have the cash on the barrelhead to pay for the city when we rebuild it. We're going to have to borrow, and we're going to have to futurize that money. But the city will continue to grow in its property tax base, because every time a new house is built in town or a house is sold, every time somebody sells a house, the city gets a windfall. They get 17% of the property tax back, all right? And the property tax goes up to the sale. It starts at the sale of the price of the house. So it's a windfall. So the better you make the city, the more desirable our city is, the more properties turn or sell or get rebuilt, the more money we get and the easier time we have to rebuild our city.
Thanks, Trent. Stacey?
Thank you. George, to answer your question, I think specifically you had said the sharing of services of fire and police. I would support looking into sharing the fire. I think as a city, we practically demand first-class service. I think that's what we all have come to expect and appreciate. Sharing our police may compromise that, but you know, we can all look into these things. We should also, of course, when we're looking at cutting costs, we need to be looking at the revenue side of things too. And recently we passed with Measure H a 2% increase in the TOT tax. That'll immediately increase our general fund of, you know, close to $500,000 a year. That's going to go up significantly once we have the hotels that are planning on coming in anyways by a couple $1 million. So we're going to be seeing a significant addition to our general fund just with these TOT taxes. And that doesn't cost us as residents anything. The other thing that we could look into that I don't think any of us would have a problem with is potentially sharing some public works with Redondo Beach. So it would free up the city yard right now. We could maybe repurpose it, reuse it, make it a smaller city yard for public works, or share it with Redondo Beach. So I would be open into looking into that. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Stacey. Anybody else? Saw a gentleman back there. Yeah. Hi.
Hi, my name is Chris, and I want to thank both candidates for coming today. We do appreciate that. I'll be brief. I have lived in Hermosa for about 15 years. I'm both a resident, a multi-unit property owner, and a business owner in downtown. And so I have interest all over Hermosa. I believe that community is very important in Hermosa, and I believe that small businesses provide a place for people, right, citizens, to come and have a community to get to know each other. One particular question I have for the candidates is, we talked about earlier about parking structures, but I would like to know from you, both Trent and Stacey, any other additional parking projects or issues that you believe should be addressed. If you can provide maybe one or two different additional parking the issues that you think should be addressed. I really appreciate that.
Yeah. Thanks for the question. Trent?
Well, in lieu of fees, certainly we should look at. You know, there's recently a restaurant that wants to basically double its size, expansion on the pier. It's a well-known restaurant here and owner in town. And, you know, he wants to make his place twice the size. And the place right next to him is empty. And our city wants to charge them $180,000 off the get-go in in-lieu parking fees, and I think that is ridiculous. I think that's just, I don't even want to say how bad I think that is, but I think it's really bad because he's not going to get a new parking spot for it. There's no new parking spaces created. What we do with that money, who knows? So I think we need to look at in-lieu parking fees. I also think that, you know, a lot of people get parking tickets around town that are just like really on the cusp of time. And I think maybe we gotta have a little bit of goodwill. Maybe if the meter maid has a little bit more discretion in giving parking tickets. I know people who've come up on the meter maid writing the ticket and they still write the ticket. But the in-lieu fee certainly, I think, would help the businesses for sure.
Thanks, Brent. Stacey?
Thank you, and thanks, Chris, for your question. I think one issue that's come up over and over is employee parking downtown and how they are given stickers that allow them to park in spots that we would all like to park in, or visitors, and it congests the downtown parking area. So I would want to look at that. You want to keep the employees safe, so you want to keep them in an area where they can easily get to work, well lit, etc. But maybe they shouldn't be parking right there in the heart of downtown. Something else that's come up is I've heard a lot more about residential parking problems, and we maybe need to look into that while we're looking at parking as a whole. And as far as in-lieu fees, Trent brought that up. He doesn't necessarily support it. I'm fine with it, but I think we need to direct that money towards something specific. And as I mentioned earlier, if we could invest that into a more walkable, safer Hermosa Beach, then it serves its purpose. So thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Stacey. Anybody else? Okay. Last chance, nobody else? All right. So we'll go on. We're going to try to breeze through the next question pretty fast and get out of here before 9. All right, the next debate questions. First, I'll flash up a couple of the reports that the City Council candidates have been looking at. If you go to this website, hbneighborhood.org, also posted right there, all the information, all the questions, all the background information, and all the reports that the City Council candidates read are available on that website. And having to do with this question is one report that's up there is from 2011, and you can click on it. It's called Reducing Alcohol Harms in Los Angeles County. And that will be part of the next group of questions. So you can click on that link. And then, for instance, in this LA County, Reducing Alcohol Harms, the entire county was divided up into 117 cities and communities, Hermosa Beach being one of them. And it showed that we had high rates of violent crime. And what the report tries to get across is that there is some relation between numbers of alcohol outlets within a city. So within the 117 cities and communities in LA County, we were ranked number 4. So 4 from the top. Next, and the data from that report, this alcohol harm study, is from 2006 to 2008. So we're talking about 10 years old. The next report is a police operations report. This has been paid for by the city, so we had police consultants come in, and this was released in 2013. The data is from 2011, and so that data is about 4 years old, but it also showed that we had high rates of violent crime and some problems with alcohol-related problems. And the next report that is also, all these links are on this website, is Hermosa Beach Police Department monthly crime statistics. So I'll get to the question here really quick. Debate question number 7. Do you believe the findings, actually, I need to go to debate question 6. Debate question 6. Hermosa Beach appears to have a history of higher rates of violent crime, part one violent crime. To what do you attribute the higher rates of violent crime in Hermosa Beach and compared to Manhattan Beach? Trent?
Okay, so now we're going to talk about alcohol on the pier. For starters, I want you all to know that I don't drink, okay? Having said that, I want to answer this question about alcohol. Hermosa Beach has always been a fun place. It's always been a place where people come here, the young and the restless, many of them, in the summertime to have fun. And yes, they blow off some steam at the bars, and we do have some issues with that. But that is not the fault of Hermosa Beach. And while it may, you know, every now and then we might overserve people, and that's not good, we need to stop that. It's really the fault of the people committing the crimes. And if we want to stop alcohol-related crimes on the pier, we need to have more police down on the pier. And to have more police down on the pier, we need to have more revenue. And to get more revenue, we need to bring in the hotels, we need to bring in Skechers, we need to boost our business base, and we need to dedicate more resources to that. And we need better policing down on the pier. Probably the findings Al talks about, how I don't think you can dispute the findings, but I don't see in the findings that I saw that we are so far out of the norm. I mean, my gosh, when you compare us to Palos Verdes or Torrance that doesn't have a lot of fun going on, you know, we're gonna have a few more things that aren't good. But it's not bad, and it's gotten a lot better. And I think that's why people come to Hermosa and why we stay here and what makes it really desirable.
Thanks, Trent. Stacey?
Thank you. As a member of the Chief's Advisory Board, we've discussed these crime numbers. And to be fair, Manhattan Beach actually had more violent crimes last year than Hermosa. That being said, we should always be looking at ways to decrease the crime in our town, things that can help that. Well-lit streets, Strand, sidewalks, and Pier Plaza, that would certainly help. Properly utilizing our cameras in the downtown and the network of private home cameras to help identify suspects and hopefully deter future crimes. And finally, I would support more police on foot and bikes in town. The chief has filled 6 vacant positions, equaling a quarter of the force in the last 2 years. So we've been able, we will be able to get police officers out of their cars and have a more personal and physical presence all around our town. It'll allow our officers to build better relationships with our community and offer a greater sense of security in our town. Thank you.
Thanks, Stacey. Okay, we'll go to debate question 7. Basically, it has to do with this alcohol harms study, which they've been mentioning. And the question is, do you believe the findings in the reducing alcohol harm study regarding the relationship of alcohol density to increase violent crime in the city? And one of the key questions would be, how many more alcohol serving outlets should be added or expanded in the city? And that'd be for Trent.
Okay, so I'm gonna take this in a little different tack since we just answered the question about alcohol and say that, you know, there, I think there's room in the city for a couple of more liquor licenses. I mean, last debate go around, we talked about Susie's up on the corner of Aviation and Prospect having a liquor license because that's a gateway property. And I think in our gateway properties, like the Hope Chapel property, if that were to ever be redeveloped, that we could have room for a liquor license there. I think a restaurant like Bonavita, Dino the owner, wants a liquor license. I think that guy is a responsible owner, and a liquor license up on Upper Pier might not be a bad idea. Certainly alcohol can cause problems. I mean, that I'm not denying that. But I don't think Hermosa Beach has a bad problem with it, and I think that it's been mitigated a lot due to our policing and our stepped up efforts and what Stacey just talked about, the new technologies, the cameras, and that we can really really knock it down, and people can come here and have fun and love to be in Hermosa Beach and stay and buy a house here and raise children and be part of our community.
Thanks, Trent. Stacey?
Thank you. Just to remind people, the question was, did we believe the findings regarding the relationship of alcohol outlet density to increased violent crime in the city? And my answer to that is yes. I've discussed this with the chief and other law enforcement officers, and also as common sense would tell us, there is a connection between alcohol consumption and violence. As a community, we've capped the CUPs in Hermosa for late night alcohol serving establishments. So a discussion about adding more is pretty much a moot point, and I think that that's a good thing for us right now. And finally, I applaud our chief for taking a proactive approach that I just found out about on this issue to help educate our youth. She's putting together a PSA to educate our youth on underage drinking, and has gotten the help of the Kings. So thank you both to the chief and our Kings for partnering with this city on this important issue.
Thanks, Stacey. Okay, we'll go on to debate question number 8. And it basically has to do with this report. This is the consultant's report, the ICMA, which it's a 56-page consultant's report, which the city paid for. And it came out in 2013. And the data was from 2011. And I'll just give one of the really quick quotes within this report. And it looked at 6 cities with that neighbor us. And one of the quotes is, when compared to neighboring communities, regardless of population, Hermosa Beach had the 2nd highest rate of both violent and property crime. And again, this is data from 2011, so about 4 years ago. And we'll go to debate question 8. What is your opinion regarding the ICMA police operations report for the Hermosa Beach Police Department? When you become a city council member, would you leave the downtown area to function as it is now? What staffing and enforcement strategies would you change in the downtown area? Trent?
Okay, so we're talking about data from 2011 and it's 2016. To me, that's old data because speed of change is occurring so quickly in our modern society that I think that's kind of outdated to refer to it, but let's just say the data is accurate. I'm sure it is. But we have new things, new technology, new ways to police, cameras, Twitter wasn't even around in 2011. Things change too quickly and very quickly. So I think we're doing a lot better job with policing the alcohol in the downtown, bottom line. If we step up our policing. We can do it with technology. We can do it with officers on bikes, on foot, on motorcycles. We could do it officers on cruisers. We can dedicate people to the downtown. We can have an alcohol squad. We can do all of these things if we have a problem with alcohol. But I don't think that we should target the businesses down there for any sort of punishment unless they're breaking the rules. And if they're breaking the rules, then yes, you do.
Okay, thanks, Trent. Stacey?
Thank you. I'm going to break it up into the three parts that you had asked in the question.
Okay.
First, you had asked our opinion on the ICMA report. I think that, yes, it is an older report from 2011, and the chief should use this report more as a guideline, and keep in mind that when this report was done, we were operating under an interim chief, and nearly 25% of our sworn force was vacant. We could look into evaluating specifically the 312s, so we could incentivize our officers to move to more of a 410 shift. It would help address exhaustion and better integrate them with our community since they would be spending more days per week here. The second part of the question was, would I support leaving the downtown to function as is? And I think there's always room for improvement, especially with the hotel coming in. Circumstances are just constantly evolving. Again, the downtown could benefit from better lighting, a police foot beat, body cameras on our officers, and better utilizing our current camera system downtown. And we should really work on building the relationship between the bars and the police. The more we can work collaboratively, the better outcome we should expect. And the third part of the question was as to staffing and the enforcement strategies downtown. The city's currently looking into this right now. Vicki will be presenting a very interesting cost-benefit analysis to the community of this downtown area in the next 2 weeks. The cost of servicing the downtown area will be discussed, and I look forward to hearing the results of that report.
Thanks, Stacey. Okay, we'll get, hopefully we'll be out of here in the next 10, 15 minutes, just a few more questions. The next report, which you can download, is called the Community Dialogue Phase 2, and that is on the website here, and you have a link to it. I think it's 35 pages. And basically, a community dialogue group got together, and these are Hermosa Beach residents, and they put together this report and debate question 9 has to do with that report. And basically, it's looking at a bigger picture on the public safety issues, and this would be the Hermosa Beach Police and Fire Department. We are, in certain respects, understaffed at the police department, and that's also occurring at the Hermosa Beach Fire Department. So part of the questions that this question goes after is related to that. Debate question 9. Data from the Hermosa Beach Community Dialogue Finance Group showed that the public safety budget in Hermosa Beach, which includes the police department and fire department, made up about 56% of the city's 2013-14 budget. What are your top priorities for the next 4 years for public safety operations in Hermosa Beach? Trent?
Okay, we'll take the police first. To have more police and more feet on the street and a better patrol, we need more revenue. We need more money, because right now, let's say they're tapped out. Well, we need either more officers or better equipment or new technology, but all that's gonna cost money. So what do we have to do? We have to grow the pie. We have to get more revenue. We have to let these hotels be built. We have to let Skechers come in. We have to have the H2O built. We got to revitalize aviation. The money from property taxes is going to come in regardless. We have to make Hermosa a place where people want to move to and buy a house. And then we spend some money on technology, on officers. I've seen recently some of the beautiful motorcycles. The new officer, that's gorgeous. That's absolutely beautiful. So maybe we have more motorcycle people on cops. Maybe we have the cameras. Maybe we have cameras more places, not intrusive ones, but that help us police the city better. Now on the fire, it's the same thing. There are less and less fires. So the old days where the guys were running out putting out fires all the time is not as prevalent. But they do other things. They go out and they do crash, safety, and people get in accidents. They run out there and help them. So they're doing multiple things. So it's the same thing, though, with the fire. not quite as stressful on those guys because they don't make quite as many calls. But we need more revenue. We need to rebuild the firehouse, and that requires revenue. So everything stems from revenue. As a guy, as a businessman, as a person who's responsible for making sure I bring in over $1 million a month in sales, I can tell you that revenue drives everything. And that's where I would focus.
Thanks, Trent. Stacey?
Thank you. Here are some of my top priorities for public safety operations. We need to support our chief, but we also need to hold her accountable. We need to keep our force fully staffed and trained. We need to provide resources that both the fire department and police department need, facilities and equipment. I support and applaud our council for providing our fire department with the equipment needs recently. We need to look into working more efficiently, as I stated earlier, with Redondo Beach and Manhattan Beach fire departments. And finally, we should look into improving the messaging and frequency of alerts of NCSL. I think we have close to 10,000 people registered to NCSL, and it's a simple and inexpensive way to communicate with our residents, and we just aren't using it enough. Thank you.
Thanks, Stacey. Okay, the last debate question. We're gonna be out of here before 9:30. 8:30, wow. So, yeah, last question. That's great.
Can you make the council meetings like that?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
Pinky swear.
Yes, I think we would.
Yeah, the last debate we had just past September, 4 hours. But 2 hours of it was audience questions, so we were happy about that. So last debate question, and then we will go to closing statements. That'll be it. Debate question 10. The goals of transparency and openness are subjects that local governments are always working to strike the right balance. State and federal laws dictate what information must be kept private and what information must be made available to the public. Debate question 10, what are your thoughts on improving transparency and openness in the city of Hermosa Beach? Trent?
Well, I think it's largely up to the individual council people. I think individual council people should not have a hidden agenda or try to obfuscate their what they're trying to get out through their questions. I think, if anything, tonight you've heard me talk and tell you exactly where I'm coming from. And I would say that you all have a good idea of who I am as a person. And transparency requires that we not only talk about what is there on the printed page, but where it is headed. What are we trying to do? And what does that entail? And let's get it out on the table and open and not be afraid. One of the things I have to do in my daily job is take a lot of criticism. I have to take a lot. I take arrows all day long. And what that does is it makes you a better person in the sense that you are able to respond to people's questions and to people's fears and to people thinking that maybe you're hiding something when you're not. And I think that is very important. It is critically important that the individual council person tell you where they're coming from and how they stand, and do it in a coherent, quick, concise way so you don't fall asleep listening to it. Thank you.
Thanks, Brent. Stacey?
Thank you. Transparency has become somewhat of a buzzword. We say it a lot, but we're not very successful at implementing it at times. We need to do everything we can to keep the residents informed and actively involved in the decision-making processes that we'll be facing. We should always strive to do better. Two great examples of transparency going on right now. I'll point him out again. He's sitting right here. Councilmember Fangary's very well-attended Community First meetings and Plan Hermosa. And finally, I promise to make transparency a priority. It's an important subject for me, and I know it is for all of you.
Thanks, Stacey. Okay, we'll have the closing statements, and it was agreed upon in advance that whoever took the first closing statement would not repeat the opening statement would not repeat on the closing. So, Stacey, you'll be doing the closing statements first, and you'll have 3 minutes.
Sure. Thank you, Alan and Trent, and to all of you watching here and at home for your consideration. I've been canvassing Hermosa, and I've talked to both long and short-term residents, renters and owners, local businessmen and businesswomen, commuters and those working from home, young professionals living in their bachelor apartments and owners of newly built strand homes, moms and dads and their kids, and the one thing I always come away with is that people love living in Hermosa Beach. They aren't living here on the way to somewhere else. They love being here. Sure, it has to do with the beach and the water and the weather. The schools are always mentioned. But what people say over and over again in one way or another is that Hermosa is a community, not just a city, that they live in a neighborhood, not just on a street, that they walk to dinner on a Friday night, walk across town with friends, and that they feel safe and secure when they come home from work. Retaining that sense of place while trying to give direction to the inevitable forces of economic, social, environmental, and political change is a big challenge. Over the last 4 years, I've come to realize that I am up for this challenge. I want my children and your children to enjoy what we have. That will take creativity, hard work, financial prudence, willingness to say yes when change is right, and a big no when change is not. I'll have 18 months in office, and my goals will be to eliminate barriers between residents and government, to provide strong financial leadership, increase citizen involvement, seek consensus and not confrontation, and strengthen the relationships with our schools. I hope to provide that sensible voice to move our city forward with pride. I will face challenges honestly and openly, always seeking fairness and a full measure of community input. I hope to earn your vote. Thank you.
Thanks, Stacey. Trent?
Well, thank you, and thank you for everybody for coming. And I believe this was a wonderful debate tonight. I believe that we really got a lot out on the table, and that what you heard from Stacey and I were straightforward answers that gives you an opportunity to make up your decision, and that you have a lot better idea of who we are and what we stand for than you did before. And I really want to applaud everybody in the audience for the questions you asked, Stacey, for your answers, and I think I was straightforward as I could be. And my whole life, I have been able to bring people together. I have been a person who is comfortable dealing with all kinds of people and all kinds of issues. I'm a very good listener. I'm a good reader. I study the issues. I let you know how I think about things and what I think about things. I care deeply about this community. I've lived here in the South Bay my whole life. My wife grew up in the South Bay. Not my whole life. I moved here, you know, 27 years ago. But my whole adult life. And I care very deeply about the community. I will be a very good councilman if you elect me. I think you have two wonderful choices tonight, which I'm very proud to be a part of. And I want you to know that I am open, I am fair, I am honest, and I will tell you how I feel, and I will not hide my agenda. And I thank you for coming tonight. Thank you for listening to us, and I appreciate your vote on March 1st.
Great, Trent, thanks. Okay, well, that's the close of the debate, and this debate will be replaying on Channel 8 on Time Warner, Channel 31 on Fios. It's available on the city website, on the Granica system. And, you know, this is a special election. This election takes place on March 1st. There's no polling places. You have to receive a mail-in ballot. You can mail the ballot back. You can also walk the ballot over here to City Hall to the city clerk's office. So that's the way the election takes place, is you have to have a mail-in ballot. And it's the date that it has to be in by is March 1st. So when the ballots have been mailed out. So anyway, that's the end of the debate. Thanks for showing up. Thanks for all the great audience questions. And have a good night. Thanks.